Welcome to Informed Sources on News Channel 3, where we talk about the week's big stories with local voices. I'm your host, Greg Hurst. Thanks so much for joining us. And in a moment, I will introduce our panel. But first, we have a lot to cover, so let's get right to it. This week, the Orpheum Theater decided to pull Gone with the Wind, the 1939 Hollywood classic, from its 2018 summer movie lineup, citing racially insensitive material. Now, the decision was met with angry comments and even some threats. Also tonight, Tennessee Senator Bob Corker had some harsh words for the president this week. What he says needs to change now. But first, our hot topic for tonight, Hurricane Harvey has ravaged the city of Houston. It even hit us. The devastation has left thousands upon thousands displaced and seeking shelter. While many in the Mid-South watch the tragedy unfold, they're left wondering what Memphis would do if it's faced with a similar tragedy. Now, to introduce our panel, first of all, WRG's political commentator, Otis Sanford, Memphis City Councilman Frank Colvett, it's good to have you here, and our hot seat guest tonight, Shelby County Emergency Management Director, Dale Lane. Dale, thanks so much for being here with us.
Hey, thanks for having me.
I'm sure they'll have some questions as well, but let's get started with this. Houston is used to flooding, but no one in their wildest dreams ever imagined they would see flooding quite like this. If this were to happen here in Memphis, would we be ready?
Well, first, let's talk about the scope of this disaster. I mean, anytime you get 50 inches, over 50 inches of water,
right?
There's going to be a disaster. Now, the question is, what's your ability to mitigate the impacts? And so, first, let me say my heart, my prayers go out to the people of Houston. We've seen some of the best in our country come out to support and to help each other. But for us here, you know, what it does is it creates a resolve to make sure that we're doing everything that we possibly can do to make sure that our citizens are safe. And so for us, there's some things that we have to look at, our critical systems. We know in that particular incident, sheltering is going to be a big part of that. And so what we have is we have a very robust sheltering capability here. We have partnership with Shelby Cares, which is our faith base, our churches, who have come on board to help us, as well as a great partnership with the Red Cross. And so we maintain those relationships. We don't wait till we're in the middle of the storm. We meet regularly, usually monthly. Many of those groups are part of our Homeland Security meetings that we have every month. And so it's about building relationships.
Do we have that capacity, though? In Houston, they're talking about anywhere between 30 and maybe 50,000 people that need shelter. Do we have that kind of capacity here?
No, we wouldn't have that capacity in and of ourselves, but we would have outside help just as they're getting. And so we're maintaining those relationships. The best example I can give for you, if you remember back, I think it was 08 with Gustav, there was a mandatory evacuation after a Category 3 hurricane of New Orleans. And so we opened 10 shelters that housed about 200 people in each one of those. And so, again, it was a statewide effort. We're not here alone. Just like Texas is not alone, you've got multiple states there. Otis and I were talking at the beginning. We sent our very best in Tennessee Task Force 1 to them immediately, and there's others across the state of Tennessee that's going to help. And if we were to have a catastrophic event here, there would be people coming to us.
And I'm sure our panelists do have some questions as well, but let me ask one other real quick here. What would be our biggest nemesis? Because we're not facing a tropical system like they would on the coast, but we do have big bodies of water, the Mississippi River, Wolf River, that kind of thing, or possibly even tornadoes. We had a lot of tornado warnings yesterday. Right. What would be our biggest nemesis? What's the thing that keeps you up at night?
Well, you know, we do our very best. I don't think that I don't want to say that I'm not concerned, but we're preparing, doing everything we can to make sure. We know that the frequency of our flooding events have seemed to increase over the last few years. I took the job in October of 2014, and it was just within a year, Mississippi River goes up to about 41 foot. And our tributaries start rising. And so if you get the Mississippi River up, and then you get the tributaries or a flash flood event, that runoff doesn't, they all go to four main tributaries. And so they flow into the Mississippi. Well, if it's up above flood stage, then now you have a problem. And so the flooding is something that's a high frequency it happens more often, and it can come with some higher impacts, but tornadoes can come in a routine, an everyday thunderstorm.
Yeah.
So I would say those two are, and then we know we live on the New Madrid fault line, and so that's that low frequency, high impact, tremendously high impact event that could occur. So we plan all hazards. We make sure that we have redundant systems in place with our communications. We have satellite radios. We have a very robust GIS system that allows us, particularly in the flooding events, where we can actually project. In that 16 flood, we were able to give 48 hours early warning notification to neighborhoods that were going to be impacted, and that's from data that was inputted from 2010 and 2011. Right. So
anything tornadoes to flooding to even earthquakes. Right, Cancel, right. do you have a question of the director?
Well, I think the first thing, our thoughts and prayers are with Houston. Absolutely. And all the damaged areas, but I think the first question I would have of you is, what more can we do? You know, from the planning and zoning standpoint, which I serve on council, we have many areas to handle the flooding that we add into our Unified Development Code. But I guess my immediate question in the aftermath of this is, what more can we do for you? What are some of the perhaps wish lists we should consider for next year's budget?
Well, I can say this. I wasn't prepared for that particular question, but I can tell you this. After 2011 floods, if you remember, several of the trailer parks that were in the Fraser area, they went under relatively quickly. There were zoning changes, and so they were not allowed to build back in there or put trailers back in there unless they raised them up. And so that's helped, because the flooding that we experienced in 16, had that not been done, we would have been right back having open shelters, and in that particular event, we didn't have to. One of the things that we found out when I first came in was that we have a lot of old construction here that don't have the seismic codes today.
We call that historic.
There you go. Yeah. But it's also it too. Could be devastating if we were to have that large earthquake. So that's something to consider is to make sure that our building codes meet those national standards. And so that just mitigates the impacts moving forward. We know in California they have. You know, the frequency of the earthquakes are a lot more than here, so a lot of their older infrastructure have been damaged.
Right.
And rebuilt to the new codes. Now, we're seeing in our interstates, you can look at these flyovers and different things, they're built to the new codes, so that's good. We're making progress, but that's an area that we could definitely look at.
Otis, a quick question. You've been here as long as any of us.
Yeah, I do have a question, and of course my heart goes out to the victims in Houston and throughout Texas and Louisiana as well. And actually, my question might be for both of you, because it probably is a public policy question. The big problem we have, as Greg mentioned, was, you know, we have tornadoes, we have straight line winds. We remember what happened in 2003 with Hurricane Elvis, and just this past Memorial Day weekend. And the big problem always is power outages that last days and days and days.
My power is still out, by the way.
Is that right? Yeah. Well, mine went out Thursday night as well for this. Yeah. But because Memphis is inundated with trees, we have trees everywhere, we have power lines above ground. That is one of the biggest problems here when we have those kind of straight line winds. Is there ever a chance that we will do something about that in terms of underground power lines? I know how expensive it is.
So some proactive things.
Yeah,
is that from a
public policy standpoint, and for you too, Dale, is that something that's even feasible in the near future?
Well, fiscally, it's always going to be a problem, but two things that come to mind. Councilman Spinosa has a committee that's being convened on disaster preparedness, so I think that we'll be having further conversations, Dale. But the second thing is, with Jerry Collins now leaving MLGNW, there will be a national search, obviously, for his successor, and I think there's an opportunity there to bring in folks from outside and to get new insights in how to do things. In terms of burying power lines, we all know that is an extraordinarily expensive, but actually I think necessary, and we all know that MLGNW has cut their funding because they just decided on cutting those trees back. So yeah. I think that in light of these storms, I think you're going to see several more trees down, which my profession is not going to like very much, my day job.
Sure.
But we're now finding this is just very necessary with too many
certainly
storms.
Certainly, there's a lot to take into consideration. Mm-hmm. A lot of food for thought there. Thank you, gentlemen, on that. And, Director, thank you so much for being here. We appreciate it. I know you have a difficult job. Thank you for all you do.